It's all yours.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks very much. Thanks everyone for attending. I see most of the people who were there in the previous session have stayed on, which is a good idea. So, I love to say always, I actually work mostly with large corporates, and the large corporates, large corporate India actually very well represented on the stage here today. And I genuinely believe that the wave of innovation that's being kicked off by the startup, India, which was very well represented by the last panel, is actually now going to be driven a lot by corporate India, by old corporate, traditional corporate India. And I think the kind of impact that you're going to see from corporates using all the cool gizmos that are listed in our panel title is actually going to be unprecedented. And we're going to see that the real, I think in 5 years from now, we're going to look back and say, this wave, it was great that the startups kicked off this wave, but the guys who really made this thing real was companies. So thanks very much to the panelists for being here. I'm going to keep the format very simple. I want to actually leave some time for questions at the end. I'm sure there are lots of people here, there are lots of product companies. People want to know, actually what's going on inside these big beasts. And how these big beasts are thinking about using technology. So I'm going to leave some time for questions at the end. What I'm going to do is just start by asking each of the panelists to talk a little bit about their experience with any of the above. Most importantly, things that have led to large impact, things where you've already seen some impact, or you're about to see some impact, or at least that it's a big priority, and you believe there will be impact. You can pick any one of them, any large initiative. I know most large initiatives, in fact, involve multiple of these technologies. And just start with your experiences. I'm going to then move on to a little bit around learnings. And when we talk about learnings, we're going to talk about particularly learnings, I think, from the angle of using products from outside, because I think the audience here is actually guys who are building those kinds of products. And then we'll, and also generic learnings, and then we'll do Q&A. So that's a very simple format. So I'll just go in this order first. Deepak, you have the privilege of starting up. The financial services guys, I have no excuse for not having lots of examples, because you guys have been doing it for the longest time. So please tell us what your experience has been.
Yeah, as a bank, I think we have been doing a lot of stuff, but since today's theme is more about what we call in our word future tech, because when I say future tech, doesn't mean everything is going to be 5 years or 3 years away. But a lot of these are the areas where a year back we started with various proof of concepts with a lot of partners. Some of you are here in this room. And some of these areas we have taken from proof of concept now to the full stage deployment. When I look at all these four themes, I think AI and machine learning is where we are far ahead of blockchain and IoT. Blockchain, still a lot of initiatives across bank, where SBI is also in the partners. We are working through Prime Chain, and we are looking at R3 and Ripple and Ethereum and some of those large blockchain consortiums to see what are the large use cases that can be built. Industry level ecosystem on blockchain, I would say, is yet to evolve to any significant scale. However, as group companies, we are seeing certain areas that we have deployed blockchain more from KYC, from internal movement of documents and contracts. So that's one area we have figured out. Where we have seen the larger success right now is in the area of machine learning. Especially more so on the credit decision, automation, lending, because in last couple of years, as we all know, 90% of data that is relevant and is created in last 24 months. So as we look at the entire investments on data warehouse, analytics, and finding some of the large use case from ROI perspective, it's on primarily around the credit decision and lending. We have seen at the back of it our online credit decision and disbursal having moved from somewhere sub 10% to today 30%. And a large part of this, we have been able to crunch the timelines and take a faster decision also on the customer segments, which are not typically banks are very comfortable lending to. For example, we are all comfortable lending to salaried segment. But moment it comes to the self-employed segment, business, I think we still need a lot more of data, document, validation before we take really a call on credit. So some of these models have started to deliver, while these are, again, as I said, early stage. Sometime very recently, yesterday, we launched something, again, very unique, which is in our app of 811. We have also launched now on the fly credit card. So pretty much in 2 minutes, you just don't open a bank account, you can even get a credit card. And this entire backend has been built on the basis of a real-time algo. When you complete the application, by the time you get your Aadhaar and PAN, we will run the backend algo to decide and tell you right there that whether you can get a card or not. So it's just 24 hours, early days before I came here. So I think that's, again, a great success factor because we are seeing close to about 30% in the first 24 hours people getting through at the back of it. Similarly, on AI, both at the backend and frontend, frontend more on the conversational banking sides where bots are still, I would say, at the stage where they are nowhere close to perfect, but I think that's again a journey where you're learning and iterating and building it to solve certain core use cases. But somehow more of this is in the backend in terms of product recommendations, depending on what kind of customers do we offer, what kind of products, so that the relationship managers or channel call centers can recommend better products. And that is again based on the different customer personas and the transaction habits. You bake all of this in and you start recommending. So I think this is where we are seeing, I would say, relatively a much larger success vis-a-vis IoT, which is relatively still, I would say, at a POC stage.
Excellent. Thanks, Deepak. I think the great learning from me is, you know, just the sheer amount of value being generated from some of the things you talked about. Because if you can do those kinds of things with a loan, for instance, you don't need all these people who, you know, crores of rupees are being spent on people who are just processing data and doing some of this stuff or collecting documents and all that. And all that goes out of the system, right?
In fact, just to add one more point, the cost of acquisition here almost is down to 30% of what the typical cost of acquisition. So it's not just it creates a larger customer opportunity, but also your ability to do credit, underwriting, turnaround time, pretty much everything much, much faster at a lower cost.
Yeah, incredible. Thanks. Piyush, want to go next?
Yeah, so what I will try to do is maybe give a little bit of an industry perspective as we see retail. So two major things which are happening, which are kind of headwinds that everybody should be aware of. One is obviously the, and I think it has been beaten to death, that the customer behavior is changing drastically. And I think some of the technologies that we talk about are nothing, but they will help serve the customer better, understand the customer better, and try to serve them in the way that they want. That is one. The second major headwinds which is happening is the machines and the importance of machines into decision-making, importance of machine into the lives of people, and the importance of machines in terms of interaction with human beings. Now, the machines of the past have been predominantly kind of slaves, as I would say, in which we have been telling machines what to do and they would basically obey and follow your instruction. But the machines of the future, maybe 5-10 years out, I think are self-learning machines and they can basically start interacting as human beings. And that's a very scary thing to be in, okay? And if you look at some of the TED Talks and things like that, machines are now behaving like ants, machines are now behaving like fishes. And so there is a lot of intelligence which is being built into machines, which obviously use of ML, AI, and so on and so forth. So as an organization, one of the fundamental things that we are trying to do is work on three areas. One is, how do you build software? How do you build sensors, which talks about the IoT and that space? And then how do you build algorithms? So these are the three broad themes that any organization has to start working on. How do you build a platform which is able to collect that data? How do you make sure that the sensors are there to understand what your customers are doing or maybe how your inventory is doing and so on and so forth? And then how do you build algorithms on top of that data, which is then going to differentiate yourself from any other competitor? And this is where the digital transformation lies. And I think a lot of people are getting confused between what is digital transformation. And the way we put it is, it is predominantly in the four buckets. One is you try to digitize the way you interact with the customer and provide a fantastic customer experience. That is the first predominant thing, which is the theme around customer centricity and so on and so forth, which has been predominant themes for a very long time. Second is, how do you make sure that your organizational operations or the way you do business is also digitized? The third is, how are you challenging the current and existing business model that you are working with and then trying to disrupt the current business model? Now, this is where the trick lies. And a lot of people are not able to, are trying to just react to what the market is doing rather than trying to do innovation and then challenge their own business model. And the fourth is around, how do you create a digital workforce so that they are A, understanding and capable to work in the some of the technologies that you talk about. So these are the four parameters around digital disruption and transformation that we are seeing. And I will kind of add on some of the specific use cases in the retail industry in the subsequent talks.
Why don't you, I mean, if there's a particular example that is top of mind.
So let me talk about IoT, right? Now obviously people have been saying there's a huge use case of sensors within the stores, within the warehouses and things like that. But there has been no scalable solution which is available till now in which I'm pretty sure it's a trend globally. I can talk about any retailer worldwide. The inventory accuracy has still not reached about 95% or 98%. It's still a challenge. So we talk about sensors and things like that, but how do you, what is the platform that you build to assimilate that information and improve that inventory accuracy, which is where the challenge lies. Now, it is now a proven point, right, in retail that everything will not be online, right? Everyone agrees that there will be physical stores in the days to come, right? That is now proven and fact, and I think there will be physical banks also, and there will be digital banks also. So how do you make sure that the person who is walking into the store, I am able to identify it in a non-intrusive way? That technology is still not mature. There's no way to identify my 100% of the customers who are walking into my store. So while these technologies are good and fancy terms, but I think when we talk about large implementations, it is still time before we can actually translate that into meaningful business cases, which actually lead to better customer service and kind of customer delight.
Okay, excellent. So I think what I'm taking away actually is that there's a lot of cool talk, right? But in terms of industrial grade solutions where you can actually extract value from them, you haven't seen so many yet, at least from a retail industry perspective. Right?
So people are scratching the surface,
yes,
is what I would say. The intent is good. The direction is good,
yes,
but I think it is still way ahead in terms of the maturity and the outcome that we want to see out of them.
Okay, great. Excellent. I'm going to come back to you and we're going to talk about placing some bets. Neeraj?
Hi, everyone. So, Kush, for me, AI has truly arrived. I just got a message from Amazon. I'm getting the delivery of my Echo as we speak. So that's arrival of true AI for me. The point that I'm trying to make here is fintech or banks versus traditional companies, they're in the thick of disruption any which ways. We're at the edge of it. And from the edge of it is when I view it and look at it, fair enough, there is available intelligence before artificial intelligence, right? Have we juiced out max on available intelligence? That's the key thought. And At times, you are kind of laced with so many options to go ahead and look at the bright stars in the picture and say, this is possible, that is possible, X, Y, Z, but have you juiced out or maxed out on creating fresh value within the available system? Now you layer it with technology, and you say, okay, fine, is analytics or predictive analytics, which is the way to go forward, and we are at that stage. And that's one of the key areas going forward. Coming back to, okay, blockchain, we haven't even thought about as of now. We created a very clear path, and that's important in the digital phase to create a path as to where do you intend to go. What are the table stakes? What is it that we need to do today? And that's true for everyone. Otherwise, you tend to kind of get tempted to experiment on to too many things and land up with virtually nothing. Experiment, yes, keep the true path, and then discover what all is possible. On the IoT front, is where, so industrial IoT has been there for quite some time, right? There have been machines, there have been sensors, there have been data out of the sensors. But the point is, what have people done with the data out of those sensors? Right? So there's industrial IoT, which is shaping up for everyone. On the world of connected appliances, I was talking to a CEO of another company yesterday, and he's like, do you really think connected appliances is or connected products is a reality? Should we really get into it? And there's an Indian company. I said, yeah, you are in, and they're in the power business. I said, you're in the power business. It's difficult to figure out a use case, but it's there. And it's there world over. So you just can't say that it's not there. It's going to be there. The whole story is around what's the objective. And every time you come back and say, what's the objective? What's the outcome that you want to drive? That's far more important than just, because the initial story around connected stuff is going to be, is it glitzy? Can I entice the consumers? Can I show 10 features? And to a point that someone was making in the morning, from a customer's perspective, yes, those are features, benefits. We all have so many, and hardly at times we get to use them. But more importantly, what do you want to do with the data that the machine is throwing back on you? There's tons of data those machines are going to come and throw back, which is the appliances or devices, whichever way. What are the organizations going to do with that data? What type of data do you need? Do you need all of it all the time? I'll give you a use case. We are on petrol variable pricing. What if energy is variable like in Europe? Can you actually tune your appliances to work at non-peak tariff times? So there are plenty of use cases, as long as you, and that's the way we work. We work use case backwards, ground ourselves in practicality, and then we start working towards what's right for us. Yes, AI towards the data part of it, sometime in 2018. IoT is already underway, and it will shape up as we move along. But there are very critical questions for all the companies to answer. For example, IoT for durable companies could put us in the same league as your sector when it comes to data security, right? So it just changes the game altogether very differently. So all those things is grounded in reality, but yes, that's the direction everyone's headed, and we are headed to, and in its own course.
And Neeraj, any things which you see are, you know, just sort of impending, you know, being deployed and showing some impact?
Many of them. So multiple projects are showing results, but they are centered more around productivity efficiency. Some of them around customer centric. So in our kind of industry, it's both ways. Pre-purchase, which is the discovery portion, needs a lot of technology, but back to my point is, I have yet to come across in the last year and a half with any technology company which I put up a use case and I say that, is this possible? The guy is going to say it's not possible. Okay, so that's the beauty of it. No one has ever come back and said it's not possible. It's possible is the answer that you always get, and people do deliver. So for me, technology is out of the way. It's about what do you want out of it, and more importantly, who's going to do it? Right? Because everyone gets swayed by fancy presentations. And then when it comes to the outcome delivery, it's got to have some inputs from the organization. It just can't be the vendor ecosystem alone that's going to deliver. Right? So there's this whole picture, and yes, there are projects that are delivering around productivity efficiency. On the pre-purchase journey, there's a lot of work that we are doing in the post-purchase, because for durables, it's a long-tail journey post-purchase, and that's where the customer lifecycle management story comes to play for everyone. And hundreds of use cases, possibilities sitting out there.
Fantastic.
So yeah.
So I'm going to actually come back to this, because slightly different from what Piyush said, right? Piyush said, you know, I'm not sure, you know, the technology is there, but I haven't seen really some industrial grade, you know, applications of it. I'm not seeing something which I can deploy right away, right? What you're saying is, no, the tech is actually quite easy. There's enough guys who will actually build me whatever industrial grade application I want. The change management, getting impact from that, actually
yep.
putting it in is actually was difficult. Yep. So let me first get Mr. Sure. Mahapatra's comments, and then we'll come back for a round on a couple of these slightly, you know, contentious topics.
Okay, I think there are a large number of product guys. I think basic question which is in their mind is that what products you are buying, rather than understanding concepts, so I'll straight away come to that. To be sure, we are buying a lot of products, and when we did an analytics on Which are the areas in which startups and fintech companies are engaged? Basically four or five areas. Analytics is one, credit is one, risk management is one. And so roughly about 90% of the startup companies who are working for the BFSI sectors are engaged in one out of these four or five sectors. So what we are seeing is that in technologies like which are directly getting to the customer, we are facing problems of scale. Yes, they have a bright concept, but when it comes to our scale, as you called it, industrial scale or whatever, I think both because they didn't have the subject matter expertise, it is not coming up. But we are buying a lot of products around internal technologies. We are buying a lot of products around, for example, internal collaboration and productive technologies, meeting room technologies, scheduler technologies, paper movement technologies. We are buying a lot of them, and startups are very good at it, and we are paying good top kind of money on those things. And these have changed. This is a win-win. You know, it doesn't take a lot of effort to do this, and we are buying those technologies. Second area in which we are buying is, you know, customer experience measurement technologies. So, for example, we did about 3 months back a hackathon, which we called Code for Bank, and we got about 20% of the entries which are based on AR and VR, and they take facial recognition, they take cloud-based technology, and they find the delta between when the customer first touches with one of my endpoints and when he goes out. What is the delta? And put it to analytics based on measurements and derive a result and put it to stakeholders. So I have implemented it in about 14 branches, and results are very, very impressive. So AR and VR based customer experience measurement tools, I'm buying quite a lot. Risk management and especially adaptive security management. And because right now time to market is shrinking every day, I'm buying a lot of startup technology in which coding practices could be better, in which DevOps can come, Agile could come, in which I can get customers on board at the UAT stage in a collaborative tool. There also I'm buying quite a bit. Blockchain, you know, overall all these technologies, what is happening, you know, like in any other industry, whether you call it retail, the middlemen are quite preponderant. So the startups are not getting value, and there is a lot of, because lack of support, lack of scale and other things, I find all of the big guys, you know, you name them in the technology world, they are working as middlemen. They are taking startup, they are not giving top money to the startups, they are laughing their way to the bank. So we are trying to connect directly, and we have three or four forums in which we call it, one we call it startup engagement, second we call it startup procurement, third we call it startup investment, and we keep on making, you know, various ways in which we get into them, and this is also finding a lot of traction.
Fantastic, thanks. You know, I have to just say that with your half a billion customer base, you probably provide the largest experimentation, lab that anyone could possibly imagine. I don't think there's, I think other than Aadhaar, I don't think there's any other bigger database than in this country.
I was telling in the previous thing, we have, you know, people are willing to work with us because we have three Ds, you know, data distribution and deep experience, and we'll have to wrap it up with digital.
Fantastic. So actually, thanks very much for actually helping me segue to the next question, which is really around, we are actually, the audience here, I am assuming, is mostly product companies, or at least this forum is about product companies. So now let's talk a little bit about learnings, and you can talk about learnings both ways, right? One, what should the product companies do to actually help you all better? Right? You can also talk about what learnings you've had in terms of how to use product companies better. And so why don't I start with the two, the retail and the durables. I'll come to the financial services guys after them. But you know, not seeing products being ready, and seeing products being too ready. I mean, tech is not the issue at all, right? I have a bigger problem. From your standpoint, if you're looking at all the product guys, I saw five AI startups outside. They have platforms in various stages of maturity. There are at least five IoT startups I've spoken to. who have got all kinds of cool sensors and all that stuff. They, by the way, don't, you know, from my discussions, I think most of them don't quite get the kinds of problems you all have. They totally understand use cases, they totally understand how to derive impact, but they don't quite get the challenges that you as individuals have when you go and drive these these programs. So as you speak to that audience, right, lessons from what they can do, lessons that you've learned from what you can do with them.
Sure, so as part of, we are also kind of working with a lot of startups, so we meet a lot of startups on a daily basis. So one of the things that we have seen is people, and I think this is more coming from management consulting in the past, that what is the business case? I will be delivering 5% uplift in sales. I will be reducing 2% in profit. These are claims which are which I think even the CEO actually is scared of making. And I think, and I see day in, day out, people coming in and saying that I will put in this solution, you will get 10% extra customers. And I said, Baba, the chief marketing officer who has spent the whole life doing it, he's not even able to commit 2%, and you are coming and committing. So one of the things, and that is where the question about maturity of the solutions comes in, is that let's build the tech. Let's build, we are open to come and experiment, and that is what digital companies are doing. They are basically trying to experiment. Let us fail. Let us not commit on something which may not be real. And that is the big differentiator. So I, one analytics startups came in and I was speaking to the founder and I said, he was talking a lot about deep learning. And I said, can you just explain me what is the difference between machine learning and deep learning? And it was kind of, he took it back and he said, if you do more machine learning, it becomes deep learning. I said, Baba, you are running a analytics startup and you don't know what it is. And then and that is where the difference lies as to what is the reality on the ground. And some of these startups need to come and collaborate, and that is where I think a lot of accelerator programs are there, which provide that platform to interact with the end user companies like us, to come and experiment. And there's nothing more than having a large customer base like us, large retail format or a footprint like us and things like that. And so let us collaborate, let us learn. I also don't know what will work. Let me be honest here. So 2 years back, if I remember, or 1.5 years back, a brilliant idea. Somebody came and talked to me about a brilliant idea. Sir, you run a loyalty program. I have about 3 million loyal customer base. Why don't we do one thing? Let us use, instead of giving points, let us give them 1/100th of a Bitcoin to them. It's an amazing idea, which was there about 1.5 years back. The platform is not ready. Customers are not ready. But if I had done that, just imagine that 3 million would have become 30 million and they would have got 800% jump in terms of their loyalty points. So ideas are there. What is the time and maturity of that solution to be implemented within a large setup is something that is yet to be seen.
Yeah.
And yeah. I'll give you one more example. So I met another startup which is in IoT space. And they said that they want to do a lot of work on the public transport area. And I said, interesting, tell me more about it. So they're going to one of the European countries and then trying to say that we will lay sensors on the roads. And based on that sensors, we'll try to control the traffic light. And I said, we are experimenting that. If that works, we'll put that in India. And I was just thinking, in Bangalore, if traffic management is to be done based on sensors which are on the road, when the roads are not there, what will you do, right? So I think there are solutions which are being thought through, but I think they are slightly ahead of the game. The practicality of some of those solutions are still to be implemented. I am still not very convinced that RFID will work 100% in all my warehouses, which is a technology which is quite old. And we are talking about sensors which are more intelligent and things like that. So there is a little bit more work to be done, not to discourage any of you, but I think it is important for us and you guys to come and collaborate, work, learn, fail, and then rework, and then relearn.
Deepak, any comments from you or Neeraj, any learnings?
So I think 3 or 4 key observations, since we work closely with a lot of them. Having an innovation lab in Bangalore also helps us connect with the ecosystem here a lot better than probably other cities. I think 3 or 4 areas. One is, while I think a lot of startups that we talk to, as some of you also rightly said, I think conceptually it's good. You understand what you're trying to build. What it lacks, obviously, is a deep domain expertise for an industry for whom you're building this. So I think because all of these, what we spoke today, be it IoT or blockchain, machine learning, these are technology enablers. Finally, it has to fit into one of the core business, like we spoke about credit. So understanding credit is as important as to say, how will this get embedded in credit? Now, a lot of times, that part of domain expertise is sitting with the different industries. It can be manufacturing, banking, financial service, anywhere. So I think building that kind of a learning interaction experience is a challenge. I understand a lot of them are bootstrapped. A lot of them probably do not have the kind of wherewithal to keep going and spending that kind of time with industries. But pick and choose at least two or three industries rather than doing like a machine gun fire that I'll try hitting someone I'll be able to shoot. I think if there is a industry, couple of industries targeted shooting, it definitely would help both build your credibility for that industry and also bringing in the deep domain expertise, because there are a lot of challenges, like Mr. Mahapatra also rightly said. If you understand what are the customer experience challenge, say, for banks, because obviously banks have issue of cost to serve, multi-channel, customer preferences are changing. And if you think that your solution can embed into one of those challenges, I think you don't have to then sell hard. I think finding a right solution for an industry and identifying that problem is where I would say spend 80% of your time, not 80% of your time in finding a right client or selling them. Because there is increasingly an awareness in most of the organizations that startups are nimble, they are targeted, they can bring good solution, at times probably much faster and in an efficient manner. So I don't think that selling is required anymore. The second part is, again, I think when you are making a choice of your tech platform, be very, very careful that are these solutions scalable? How will these integrate into the core systems of the bank? That means also understanding the kind of systems banks use predominantly. If you're talking to banks who have probably an entire API stack, it's much easier to integrate. Then you know that probably that will work better. If you are looking at something which sits into one of the customer-facing channel, then are you also building this more as an SDK, which is a plug-and-play? If this integrates with SDK, will this increase the size of an app that you eventually are rendering? So it may not be just about what you are developing, but how it fits into the larger scheme of things. And the third, which is most important, is a lot of times a solution does not sell or gets accepted in isolation. It has to be part of an ecosystem. So for example, when I said IoT is still a little premature or blockchain is, we understand what IoT is doing. We have piloted with some cases wherein, say, commercial vehicles and in fleet operator, we have installed these IoT device, trying to figure out that for how long are these machines or vehicles operating. Thereby, you can look at your collection and how you price some of these things. Obviously, going forward, as more and more products become service, for example, there is a tire company which is now running tire as a service. So you don't have to buy these tires if you are a fleet operator and if you are running, say, 200, 300, 400 trucks. It costs hell a lot of money to buy those. So with that sensor, you know what is the running kilometer. There is a bank which is ready to finance that. And obviously, there is a business model where if the tire is damaged, it needs to be replaced, then you have a service network which replaces it. That means you need a manufacturer, you need a consumer, you need a service point, and you also need a financial service provider. So it's an ecosystem that's going to finally adopt, take your solution. If you just go to a bank or you go to a fleet operator or a tire company, probably they may not see a right enough use case or urgency to take that as your solution. Last week I was in US and I was talking to some people and they said the largest selling insurance, vehicle insurance in US now is Metro Mile. Now, why Metro Mile does well is because not everyone drives the same amount of distance or probably have similar driving habits. And they've been able to put the IoT sensor in each of the car. And depending on your driving habit, number of kilometers that you drive, the terrain that you drive, the number of times you accelerate and you apply sudden brake and your all these things, at the end of it, you get like your electricity bill or telephone bill, a monthly insurance premium. So if you are probably say on a holiday for 2 months, all you pay is a base premium, which, and you don't pay anything which is a mileage based premium. So I think there is a sizable opportunity when you look at each of these stack, irrespective of where you apply. One more, in fact, startup, I'll take one more minute just to make sure that so I was talking to him and they are based out of Hyderabad. And he said, I have built a 3D sensor camera through which you can exactly figure out the extent of damage by clicking a picture. And they have built in, obviously, at the back end, the AI algo to look at. And if there is a small value claim, insurance companies, they don't need a surveyor anymore. So you click a picture, you'll be able to validate. So I think people are thinking about solution rather than just technology. And as long as your product is focused on the solution and a problem that it's solving, I think there's a huge opportunity irrespective of whichever of the spectrum or industry or technology that you pick.
Excellent. Any?
So quickly, my learnings and my takeaways and my journey so far. First, and I'll be absolutely blunt, and it's true for every sales guy, I've been a business guy all my life. Understand your customer and the business model. Most of the product companies and people come in for is selling what is there in stock. Right, so solutions have overlaps, and that's where being open to learning, both sides of the table is important. That's one. The other aspect, which is a change and which a lot of product companies kind of fight it out with me, is very simple. The traditional model now, digital is more of an interface with business rather than traditional IT work, right? The way charges are levied, and I'm going right to the operational level, no longer is business tuned to kind of understanding the way structured, disciplined IT works, that my charges are going to be based on time, hours, this. You're dealing here with an absolutely fuzzy area experimenting. You're dealing with a lot of gray stuff sitting out there. No one's going to even be able to verify the timesheets and the charges. So the way the commercials get done at times and the way I do them very simply is there's the objective, there's the money, this is the time we agree upon, this is the milestones, this is the project charter. Don't come to me with detailed breakups of XYZ manner spent, and that's how it's going. I'm not going to be able to figure out that. Right? So there's a commercial operational element to it, which at times people find a little difficult, but they adapt to, and we kind of, because business is still dealing with this reality of digital. And so is both sides of the table. The other one is we work with startups, yes. And most of the projects are, when you look at the end state, it's kind of big. But I think the way we figured out our path is all based on pilot and scale. 100% everything is pilot and then scale. So if at pilot it's not working, we'll just scrap it. But so those couple of learnings, and that's where we start seeing value even with startups. Some of them have done some brilliant work and are doing some brilliant work for us. And I did spend some time outside, and I'm going to go back there again. There is enough possibility.
Yeah, excellent. Any final remarks?
Yeah, two things which I will like to tell to this audience. First one is that. Many of you, when you come to me, you assume that, you know, I'm in the Stone Age or something like that, so you can bring something. But pressures of competition and pressures of survival is as valid on me as it is on you. So I have also evolved. And many times, change management is a big pain for me. So I would like my legacy technology or something which I acquired maybe two years back, I don't want to throw it away and acquire your technology. So when you are creating technology, all of you are creators, always think that how can it be implemented in a modular fashion? Somewhere it has not been started at all, somewhere it has already gone halfway and you can go and plug in there, and somewhere it is at the mature stage. So look at that, it's very important, it's a very important business model, think how you can work on that. Second thing that has worked with many startup engagement is where, you know, people, they come, you know, they come with a laboratory model where two or three transactions, and when they see State Bank of India 10,000 transactions every second, and suddenly it fails. So one model that will work for you, as I think Deepak also told, is how can you come collaborate and do a kind of a body swap kind of an exercise where you lend some of your talent or you work yourself in our ecosystem, many times probably at a price which is an entry level kind of a price, so that you learn the domain, because data is important, otherwise your testing will be inaccurate. And third and most important is again a little philosophical, but I don't fail telling about it, is that there must be a realistic blend of valuation and value creation. But otherwise, you know, if the market takes that valuation parameter is number of customers acquired, your technology will go towards customer acquisition rather than customer value creation. Thank you.
Fantastic. Just thanks. To add to his point, sorry, Kush, yeah. Quickly one. Digital inside a traditional organization is also a startup.
And
that's the lens.
And I think that's, sensitization is actually very important,
so
because
it's
the journey that you guys
sides.
Are on is an equally important startup journey within your own companies. So I think 30 seconds that will last this thing. I think one, you know, these are the real, you know, so after you pitch to the VCs who were there on the last panel, right, these are actually the most important guys. So I don't know, actually in fact, I don't even know whether the VCs, the guys who give money are more important or the people who give you the pilot business is more important, right? It's a toss up, right? So they are very open. They are seeing impact and they're ready to deploy, right? I think that's one big message. You know, State Bank of India, right? You cannot think of an organization that you would think is more sort of old world, but they are, you know, running, right? They are running on all fronts on these dimensions. Technology needs to be industrial grade. It needs to integrate with legacy. It needs to be a solution. It can't just be a dabba, right? This dabba is very cool. It works very well. You know, that's not good enough, right? That's very important. Understand. Third point, understand what it takes to get customer success, right? They have lots of clues over here, right? What's the reality on the ground? Understand my change management challenges. Understand the ecosystem creation that I need to do to actually make this happen. Understand the business model that I will have to create to actually use this technology and make it happen, right? These are very, very important lessons because, and as a tech entrepreneur, it's very hard to think of some of these things, but you know, if you're going to build great product companies in India, we're going to have to actually generate our initial successes here. And these are the, you know, some of the guys who we're going to have to do it with. There are 50 other such people I know who I have actually counted who are doing similar things in companies, and I think by next year there'll be 100. And finally, I think there are a lot of systematic engagement initiatives on. There are startups, there are accelerators, there's incubators, accelerators, there are all kinds of partnership programs, investment programs. And I think the biggest thing a product company can get, if I was a product company, I would look for some mentors who are the guys who give money, but I would actually look at mentors who are people in companies who are experiencing with, who are tinkering with this stuff and trying to make it happen. Because the kind of learning you can get from this ecosystem and from actually generating success will be invaluable going forward. Thanks, Atul. Sorry for violating all your time.